How's it going, everybody?
Living the dream, man.
Good. Living the dream?
Mm-hmm.
Amen.
Asking how your favorite.
Can we just, can we just, like, give a clap to the worship team again? So I want to open up with prayer. Prayer is super important. Without prayer, you know, we don't have anything to combat the enemy. So let's all just bow our heads right now. Lord, you are so good to us. Your word tells us that your love endures forever, God. We thank you for what you've done for us, what you're continuing to do for us, God. Thank you for this word that we can get into together, learn more about you. Lord, I pray that you would speak right now, that you would soften hearts, even mine, Lord, to this message. Because really, Lord, this is your gospel that you've given to us. It's the good news. So we thank you for that, God, and I pray that you bless this time. Thank you for everyone here. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Okay, so I titled this message, The Size of Grace, because I was listening to this song by a group called Beautiful Eulogy, and the song's called The Size of Grace, and they're talking about just, like, the magnitude of what God has done for us. And I was thinking about that, and I was like, how often do I allow myself to be impressed or in awe of what God has actually done for me? And, you know, I think about these times in my life where I've had these spiritual highs. I'm real passionate about the gospel. I'm like, yo, I want to tell this friend about Jesus. I want to tell this friend about Jesus. I want to, you know, this food, this extra food in the house, let's give it to the hungry. All these clothes, I don't need it. Let's give it to the poor. And then I think about the times where I'm not so passionate, the times that I'm not in the Word, the times I'm not telling people about Jesus. And I'm like, these are so drastically different. Like, how do I get from one place to the other? Like, what has caused me to end up there? And how do I get back to where I'm supposed to, where I'm in awe of God's grace? And I wanna read two definitions to you that I looked up on Google. Shout out Google. So mercy, it is compassion or forgiveness shown towards someone whom it is within one's power to punish or harm. So in other words, not giving you the judgment that you deserve. That's mercy. Grace, in Christian belief, the free and unmerited favor of God as manifested in the salvation of sinners and the bestowal of blessings. So, in other words, getting what you don't deserve, gifts you don't deserve, that you could never earn. And I want to talk about a story that has to do with mercy and grace, and we're actually throwing it way back to Genesis. So if you guys have any Bibles, I encourage you to open up to chapter 12, and I'll give you a second to do that. But we're going to be talking about Abram, before the Lord renamed him Abraham. But so, chapter 12, verse 1, it says, the Lord had said to Abram, leave your native country, your relatives, and your father's family, and go to the land that I will show you. I will make you into a great nation. I will bless you and make you famous, and you will be a blessing to others. I will bless those who bless you, and curse those who treat you with contempt. All the families on earth will be blessed through you. So Abram departed as the Lord had instructed, and Lot went with him. Abram was 75 years old when he left Haran. He took his wife Sarai, his nephew Lot, and all his wealth, his livestock, and all the people he had taken into his household at Haran, and headed to the land of Canaan. When they arrived in Canaan, Abram traveled through the land as far as Shechem. There he set up camp beside the oak of Moreh. At that time, the area was inhabited by the Canaanites. So God calls Abram out. He calls him to go, and he promises him these things, right? So then verse 7 it says, then the Lord appeared to Abram and said, I will give this land to your descendants. And Abram built an altar there and dedicated it to the Lord who had appeared to him. After that, Abram traveled south and set up camp in the hill country, with Bethel to the west and Ai to the east. There he built another altar and dedicated it to the Lord and worshipped the Lord. Then Abram continued traveling south by stages toward the Negev. So God makes these promises to Abram, right? He's like, this is what I'm going to do for you. This is how people are going to be blessed through you. This is the land I'm going to give to you and your people. So Abram is, keep in mind, there's nothing that he did that God is like, okay, so now I'm going to give you these blessings. God just, in his own will, decided to give this to Abram. So, lost my spot. So he is like compelled by these promises that God has made to him to worship God. He builds an altar there and he worships the Lord. Then it says in verse 10, same chapter, so now kind of time has passed, and it says, at that time a severe famine struck the land of Canaan, forcing Abram to go down to Egypt, where he lived as a foreigner. So life happens to him. Life happens. It pushes him away from this area that God had promised to him. And it says, as he was approaching the border of Egypt, Abram said to his wife Sarai, look, you are a very beautiful woman. When the Egyptians see you, they will say, this is his wife. Let's kill him, then we can have her. So please tell them you are my sister. Then they will spare my life and treat me well because of their interest in you. So Abram's now thinking about himself. He's like, dang, like, my wife is fine. These dudes, they're rich, they're powerful. They're going to want my wife. They're going to kill me. I don't want to die. So listen, girl, tell them you're just my sister. This way I can live. Because you love me, right? You care about me. So, like, you don't want me to die. So now in verse 14 it says, and sure enough, when Abram arrived in Egypt, everyone noticed Sarai's beauty. When the palace officers saw her, they sang her praises to Pharaoh, their king, and Sarai was taken into his palace. Then Pharaoh gave Abram many gifts because of her: sheep, goats, cattle, male and female donkeys, male and female servants, and camels. So far it's going pretty well for Abram. His plan is it's working out. But then it says in verse 17, but the Lord sent terrible plagues upon Pharaoh and his household because of Sarai, Abram's wife. So Pharaoh summoned Abram and accused him sharply. What have you done to me? He demanded. Why didn't you tell me she was your wife? Why did you say she is my sister and allow me to take her as my wife? Now then, here is your wife. Take her and get out of here. Pharaoh ordered some of his men to escort them and sent Abram out of the country along with his wife and all his possessions. So then it kind of takes a turn for the worst because of this lie that Abram has told about his wife. And I don't know how, like, plagues made Pharaoh realize, like, oh yeah, I just took somebody else's wife, but the Lord worked. And he realizes, and so he calls Abram into his quarters, and he's like, yo, dude, like, why did you do me dirty like this? Now I'm getting all these plagues sent on me. But we have to remember, the Pharaoh could have killed Abram because of what he did to him. He could have killed both of them, him and his wife. But instead, he just, like, throws them off. He's like, just get out of here. Because God made promises to Abram. God had mercy on Abram in this situation. God could have let Pharaoh kill him, but he didn't. In verse 13, it picks up, it says, so Abram left Egypt and traveled north into the Negev, along with his wife and Lot and all they owned. Abram was very rich in livestock, silver, and gold. From the Negev, they continued traveling by stages toward Bethel, and they pitched their tents between Bethel and Ai, where they had camped before. This was the same place where Abram had built the altar, and there he worshipped the Lord again. So he went back. You know, God made him these promises, and he worships the Lord there. He built this altar, worshipped the Lord there, because he was in awe of these promises that God made him. They compelled him to worship, right? But then life happens to him. Pushes him out, and he goes down to Egypt, and he gets distracted, starts thinking about himself. And he gets all these really nice things, but things go bad. So then he, by the mercy of God, is compelled out of Egypt, and he goes back to where it started. He goes back to where God made him these promises, and it compels him to worship God again. So he goes back, he reminds himself of what God has done. He's like, I've done these things, I've messed up, how do I get back to where I once was with the Lord? Goes back to where it all started. And I think that we do the same thing sometimes, where we're in awe and we're worshiping God because of these promises he's made to us, but then life happens, things distract us, and we start to lose our passion. Mm-hmm. We start to lose our focus on what really matters, on those promises. How do we get back there? How do we get back to being passionate, to being focused, right? We go back to where it all started for us. You know, we go back to our first love, which is the gospel of Jesus Christ. So he goes back to this altar and he worships God there. And we go back to the gospel, right? As Christians, as believers, sometimes we hear the gospel message so many times, right, for those of us that are believers here, that we almost get desensitized to it. We start to like not so much like be like so crazy about it, like, oh man, like this is so awesome. We're like, yeah, you know, it's the gospel. But that's how God tells us he loves us. That's what God has done for us. You're only where you are now and at right standing with God because of the gospel.
Thank you, Lord.
How do we get tired of that?
Thank you, Jesus.
You know, my dad, anytime he hugs me and tells me that he loves me, I know he means it because of what he's done for me, right? But he hugs me and he tells me he loves me, and it's the 3 billionth time that he's done that, right? But I need it every time. Mm-hmm. I don't get tired of it. Every time he comes to me and tells me he loves me. We get tired of the gospel. That's God hugging us and saying, I love you, this is what I've done for you. How do we get tired of that? We need that the 3 billionth time.
Amen.
Just as much as we need it the first time. Sorry, I gotta get back in my notes for a second. Okay. So if the gospel is this place where it all started for us, we have to remind ourselves of what the gospel actually is. So I want to flip to Romans real quick, going from the way throwback to something only a couple thousand years old. It's not really that much of a throwback. But Romans chapter 5, if I can even find it myself, that'd be dope. Okay, Romans chapter 5, verse 8. But God showed his great love for us by sending Christ to die for us while we were still sinners. So while you were a sinner, he died for you. When you did nothing to deserve it. Just like Abram, he didn't do anything to deserve these promises, to deserve God's grace or his mercy. God still showed it to him. Why? Because he wanted it. The same thing with us. While we were sinners, well, you were a sinner, well, I was a sinner, Christ died for us. There's nothing we could have done that deserved that, right? Romans chapter 3, verse 23 through 25, I'll just read that real quick. It says, for everyone has sinned. We all fall short of God's glorious standard.
Amen.
Yet God, with undeserved kindness, declares that we are righteous. He did this through Christ Jesus when he freed us from the penalty of our sins. For God presented Jesus as a sacrifice for sin. People are made right with God when they believe that Jesus sacrificed his life, shedding his blood. And I'll stop that there. So, if you're thinking, yeah, well, this is for sinners, right? But I'm good. No, we've all sinned. We've all fallen short. We all deserve the penalty, the death sentence. But because Jesus came down with this perfect life and then died on the cross for us, now we're made right with God. Romans 6, verse 23, just to back that up, it says, for the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life through Christ Jesus our Lord. So yes, Scripture does tell us that if you are a sinner, you deserve to die. Straight up. Like, not sugarcoating it. And Jesus, in his ministry, he talked a lot about what that looks like. What does it mean to die like a spiritual death? Well, there is a place called hell. Jesus talked about it a lot more than he talked about heaven. And if we are sinners, we deserve to go there,
mm-hmm.
right?
Mm-hmm.
But because of what Jesus has done, now we don't have to. So just a brief rundown of the gospel just to put that all together. I wrote this down for myself so that I could just make it brief. God made man to be with him, Adam and Eve. He made us to dwell with him in fellowship. But then man sinned, and therefore deserves punishment and can't be with God. Because God can't be around sin. So that puts a divide between us and God. Because God's perfect. Jesus tells us that that punishment is hell. That's eternal separation from the Lord. But because God loved man, he sent his son, Jesus Christ, to live a perfect, sinless life and then die on the cross for us. So Jesus, he comes down, he's born through a virgin, and then lives for 30 years, then starts his ministry. It's a three-year ministry. He's going around, he's healing people, he's preaching good news, he's revealing what Scripture means, that the whole time these people have gotten wrong. And he's saying all these things that prove he's the Messiah. He lives his perfect life. And then people hate him and they kill him when he's 33 years old, about 33 years old. And they nail him to a cross. And he hangs up on the cross and says, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." And then after, I believe it's like 6 hours of him hanging on this cross, dying, he gives his spirit up and he dies, right? And like, I imagine being the disciples, you know, they've been walking with the Lord in this ministry for the last 3 years. And then they see Jesus die on the cross and they're like, this was our hope. This was everything we put our hope in, and now he's dead, right? But what they forget is that Jesus told them he was going to come back. And that's the string that holds this whole gospel together, is the fact that 3 days later, after he was buried in a tomb, that no one could have moved this stone, right? He comes back. He's risen again by the power of the Holy Spirit, right? This is the thing that holds the gospel together. Without that, without the resurrection of Jesus Christ, none of it makes any sense. We can't have the resurrection if he doesn't have the resurrection, but he did. Because 500 witnesses, the Bible tells us, saw him after he died. 500 people. You can't just like brush that under the rug and be like, it didn't happen.
Right.
So he was raised to life by the power of God's Holy Spirit. When we believe this and turn from our sin to follow Jesus, spiritually our old self dies with him, and we are also raised to life as a new creation by his Holy Spirit. So the same Spirit that raised Jesus to life raises us to life, and we're now reconciled with God because of that. So that's the gospel, right? And in a nutshell. We could just talk about how awesome the gospel is for hours and hours and hours and never get tired of it, because it's so, so good. So that's the mercy side of the gospel, is we deserve to go to hell because of what we have done, but not because of what Jesus has done. We don't have to. And the grace side, so remember, mercy is not getting what we do deserve, and grace is getting something we don't deserve. Excuse me. The grace side, there's actually a lot to it. There's a lot of promises wrapped up in the gospel that I myself forget about sometimes. And when I read the scriptures, I'm like, oh my gosh, there's so much to this. There's so much that he promises us. So not only are you saved from sin and death, you deserve, but God has made promises like Abraham you don't deserve. And I have a long list of them. I'm going to read through all of them. But I'm not going to flip through each verse in the scriptures, but I have it written down. If you want to see where it says it in the Bible, I will show you after. So you're given God's grace. That's in Ephesians. You're given eternal life. It talks about that in John. Become sanctified and justified, meaning God the Father no longer sees you as guilty and sinful, but now he sees Jesus' righteousness in the place of that on you. So you're reconciled to God. That's in Romans. You become a new creation. That's in 2 Corinthians. You become his beloved. That's in Ephesians. You become his child. That's also in Ephesians and in John. And because of that, you're an heir to the throne, and you get an inheritance. Part of that, you know, being a place prepared in glory just for you specifically, each of us. That's also in John and in 1 Peter and in Romans. God calls you his friend. That's in John. You're baptized into Christ's body, and into the church. That's Christ's body here on earth. It's the church. That's his family. That's in 1 Corinthians and in Romans. You get to have fellowship with God. That's in 1 John. You dwell with Christ, and you'll be seated with him. He talks about that in John and in Ephesians. You receive the Holy Spirit of God, and he dwells within you, and you're sealed by him. So the same Holy Spirit that raised Jesus to life, again, that is now in you if you are in Christ. And you're sealed by it. That's a promise. It's a mark, right? So back in the day, these kings, they would have these rings, right? And there's a seal on it. So you put the hot wax on, you know, the law or the letter, whatever you're sending, mm-hmm. and then they press the ring down on it to say, like, I approve of this. That's what the Holy Spirit does for us. That's the mark saying, this one is mine. He belongs to me. I approve of this. Right? So you're sealed by the Holy Spirit. Ooh, yeah. Jesus tells us that he's the comforter, the Holy Spirit, and he never is going to leave us.
Amen.
Sorry, I got sidetracked. I was getting excited.
That's
in 1 John. It's also in John and Ephesians and 1 Corinthians. Because of the Holy Spirit living with us, we're given different spiritual gifts, like just like teaching is an example of that. I won't go through the long list of all the different types, but when you're saved, you get these. And not everybody gets the same ones because God's like, no, I made you to be unique, and that's really cool. This way you all need each other. That's in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, just that whole chapter like talks about it a lot. One of the coolest ones, in my opinion, for here on earth is we have the possibility to get victory over our sin. So when we turn from our sin, turn to Jesus Christ, now he gives us a way out of sinning against him. That's in Romans, just chapter 6. Just like read chapter 6 of Romans. You know, just like read Romans. Like, it's so good. And this is the one that I think really gets us through till the end. We have the blessed hope of Christ's return when he comes back one day to take us home. Because this is no longer our home. That's in Titus chapter 2. So these are some of the promises that are wrapped up for you, gift wrapped, in the gospel, right? That you don't deserve. He's going, here it is. You want it? Just take it. It's free. You can have it. You can have it. It's yours. All you have to do is believe in me. What? That's crazy. And as Christians, when we get desensitized to the gospel, I think it's because we're not really allowing ourselves to take in what that means for us. Look at all those promises. It's stuff that we can't even comprehend. What is a place prepared for us in glory? I don't know what that looks like, yo. It's nothing I've ever seen here. Some translations describe that as a mansion. What? I'm a poor kid from the city. I'm getting a mansion one day? That's dope. So this is the grace of God. These things that we don't deserve that we're getting. Because of what Jesus Christ has done for us. Remind yourself of these every day. When you get at a point where maybe you're starting to lose your passion, maybe sin is starting to creep in, you're getting distracted, school is hard. I know, guys. I know life is hard. Some of you know that more than anybody. This is what gets you through. Be like Abram. Go back to where it all started. Go back to the gospel that saved you, that promises you these things. Get back to that, because without that, you have nothing. Cherish them. Don't let it go. You know, hold it close to you, the gospel, because that's what's going to give you your passion. And you sometimes suffering gets in the way. And we start to get discouraged and we're like, man, I didn't know it was going to be like this. You know, I didn't know these things were going to come my way. The word promises suffering. We're in Romans chapter 8, it says, verse 18 through 25, I'll read. If you guys want to flip down, I'll give you a second. But says, yet what we suffer now is nothing compared. Oh, excuse me, guys. I'm going to go back a couple verses. Verse 15. So you have not received a spirit that makes you fearful slaves. Instead, you received God's spirit when he adopted you as his own children. Now we call him Abba, Father, for his spirit joins with our spirit to affirm that we are God's children. And since we are his children, we are his heirs. In fact, together with Christ, we are heirs of God's glory. But if we are to share in his glory, we must also share in his suffering. And like that sometimes is like, oof. You had me with it, and now I'm like drawn back a little bit because I don't like suffering. But this is what Paul says in Romans, and it's so encouraging. Yet what we suffer now is nothing compared to the glory he will reveal to us later. These promises. For all creation is waiting eagerly for the future day when God will reveal who his children really are. Against its will, all creation was subjected to God's curse, but with eager hope, the creation looks forward to the day when it will join God's children in glorious freedom from death and decay. For we know that all creation has been groaning as in the pains of childbirth right up to the present day. And we believers also groan, even though we have the Holy Spirit within us as a foretaste of future glory. For we long for our bodies to be released from sin and suffering. We too wait with eager hope for the day when God will give us full rights as his adopted children, including the new bodies he has promised for us. We were given this hope when we were saved. If we already have something, we don't need to hope for it. But if we look forward to something we don't yet have, we must wait patiently and confidently. So on the day you were saved, you were given this hope. And that's what pushes you through the suffering. That's what helps you persevere. It's not going to be your own strength. Listen, your own strength is not going to get you through any of this stuff. The sufferings that Jesus went through, right? It's gonna fail. Love for people, your own love for other people, is gonna fail. It's gonna fade away. What will not fade away is the love of Jesus Christ in you. That's what will not fail. The promises of the gospel, that's what will not fail. That's what will last forever. And here's why it's so important for us to persevere, right? Our name of the club is Campus Ambassadors, and the reason behind that is because we're ambassadors of Jesus Christ on campus. But whether or not you're on campus, you're an ambassador of Jesus Christ. 2 Corinthians, if you guys want to flip there with me, but you don't have to. Chapter 5, verse 20. So, we are Christ's ambassadors. God is making his appeal through us. We speak for Christ when we plead, come back to God, for God made Christ, who never sinned, to be the offering for our sin, that we could be made right with God through Christ. So now, Jesus, after he was raised to life, right, he walked around for, I think, like 40 days? If I'm wrong, correct me. 40 days?
Some nights?
Yeah. No, only the days. But then afterwards, he ascended to heaven, right? So Jesus isn't physically here on earth anymore. So we now act as his ambassadors. We go out and we preach this gospel. The same things that I just told you about the gospel, we tell others about the gospel. Because Jesus wants everybody to be saved, right? So Jesus wants everybody to be saved, and his Holy Spirit's in you. You want everybody to be saved. So you're going to have that passion. You're going to have that zeal to go out. And like I said, it's not because of your love for them, because your love for them will fail. It's because of Jesus' love for them, right? So what does this look like to be an ambassador of Jesus Christ? Well, I'll just flip to Matthew real quick. And this is before Jesus ascended in heaven, before he left the earth. I'll set the scene, right? He's talking to his disciples. These guys walked with Jesus for 3 years, watched him die, lost all their hope, and then saw him after he came back to life, and their hope is reignited again, right? Then it says chapter 28, verse 18. Then the 11 disciples left for Galilee, going to the mountain where Jesus had told them to go. When they saw him, they worshipped him, but some of them doubted. Some of them still doubted. after everything that they've seen him do, they still doubted.
Mm-hmm.
And if they saw him, they physically saw him after he came back to life and doubted, yo, we are definitely going to have times when we doubt. So this is what Jesus says. Jesus came and told his disciples, I have been given all authority in heaven and on earth. So he's like, just want to make something clear to you guys real quick. All the power, that's mine. That's mine. So don't doubt, because I have it. Don't stress out. I got it. Then he says, therefore, go and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and the Holy Spirit. Teach these new disciples to obey all the commands I have given you. And be sure of this, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. That's that confidence that Paul is talking about, that we have as we wait. So that's what it looks like to be an ambassador of Jesus Christ. You know, in Christianity, we call that the Great Commission. And they did. They went out, and they preached the gospel, and they baptized people in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. We do that to this day. 2,000 or so years later, we're still talking about Jesus Christ, right? Because that's the impact that he's had on us. So this is what we're called to do. That's why it's so important to go back to these promises that are going to help us through, because there's a task at hand. There's something to do while we wait for the Lord to come back. You know, as much as we have this grace and these promises, these entail responsibility. And we have a responsibility to the ministry of Jesus Christ to continue this ministry, to continue to tell people about him. So there's some of us in this room who aren't going to be here next semester. They're leaving MCC, and it makes me really sad. But all of us are leaving for the summer, unless you're taking summer classes. But we're going out and we're doing our own thing, right? So as I was preparing for this, I was like, God, like, what do these students need to hear right now as they go out and continue the rest of their lives? What do they need to hear? And God was like, what do you need to hear? Well, one, I need to hear again that you love me. Because I remember I don't get tired of that. I need to hear that you love me. Tell me again. Tell me again. So he was like, tell them again. And it's like, two, what am I supposed to do? Now that I know that you love me, what do I do with that? And he's like, tell them that they need to tell others. Just preach the gospel. That's what you're called to do. You're called to love others and preach the gospel.
Mm-hmm.
Called to help others. What did Jesus do? Jesus said, I'm going to paraphrase, but he talked about, you know, helping those who need help. He talked about giving food to the hungry, you know, being there for the poor, for the orphan, for the widow. He says, what you do for the least of these, you've done for me. So he's saying, like, again, this idea of your love for other people is going to fade away, but if your love for me is rooted in my love for you, that won't fail. So we're called to this. There's a big task at hand. We can only accomplish it when we're rooted in the gospel of Jesus Christ. That's the only time. That's the only time we have victory. So I want to encourage you guys, especially those of you who are leaving this campus to go to other campuses to maybe work a job, tell people about Jesus Christ. And if I can give you a couple of tips, tell people about Jesus Christ and how he has changed you. Tell them your testimony. Because I was talking to my one of the youth pastors at my church, and he said, when people ask you about the Grand Canyon, after you take a trip to the Grand Canyon, and you start going, well, it's so many feet deep and so many feet wide and long, and it's been around for this long, that's not what they're asking about. When they ask about your trip to the Grand Canyon, they don't want to hear all the numbers, they don't want to hear all the, you know, these facts, right? They want to hear about your experience at the Grand Canyon. Was it cool? Did it take your breath away? Like, what was it like? What did it look like? They want to hear about how you experienced it. When people ask you about Jesus, or when you talk to people about Jesus, they don't want to hear, well, you know, here's all these theological reasons why I believe in Jesus. They want to know what happened to you that made you believe in Jesus. for me, it's like, man, I grew up in the church. I was 13 years old. I was struggling with depression, struggling with a lot of sin in my life. I wanted to commit suicide. One day I was about to do it. Jesus literally spoke to me in that moment. I say literally, not like an audible voice, but like in my mind. And he was like, I love you. You know this. What are you doing? In that moment, I shouted out, Jesus, save me. And he did in that moment. That was my coming to know Jesus Christ. That's what they want to hear. They don't want to hear all these crazy theological details, even though those are good things, right? Those are good things. But if they don't know Jesus, they just want to know, why should I follow Jesus? So tell people about how Jesus changed you. Do it with confidence. Do it with boldness. Be bold. Jesus says, I've been given all authority and power in heaven and earth.
Ooh, Jesus.
And his Holy Spirit dwells with you. You have boldness in you. Mm-hmm. You have power in you. Mm-hmm. When you tell people, don't tell people like, man, I really hope that they don't come back at me with some really good details about evolution and make me think I don't know what I'm talking about. No, you know what you're talking about. Jesus saved you. There's a boldness to that. And you enter each conversation going, this is the faith that I have. Nothing is going to change that. It's not going to make me waver. It's not going to make me double think it. Do it with passion. Be passionate. He changed your life. There's passion in that. There's zeal. Be excited about the gospel.
Woo.
Get Puerto Rican with it. Throw your hands around when you're talking about it.
No, you're not right now. No, you're not.
There's an excitement. There's a passion. Do it often. Often think about Jesus Christ. Even when people get tired of it, I don't care. Because I care about you this much, right? I want you to know and have the same thing that I have. Because it's not just for me, it's for everybody. John 3:16 says, for God so loved the world, it's for everybody. But I don't just want to act like everyone, like I know for sure that everyone in this room is secure in salvation. I'd like to think that. I'd like to have hope in that. And I pray over that. But if there's anybody here who does not know for sure if you're secure, that seal of the Holy Spirit is on you, if you have those promises, you know, Scripture tells us how we can know for sure, how we can get to this point, right? So I'm going to flip to Romans chapter 10. And I would encourage you guys to flip there with me if you have a problem. Okay, yes. So Romans chapter 10, verse 9 through 11. This is what Paul writes. If you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For it is by believing in your heart that you are made right with God, and by confessing with your mouth that you are saved. As the Scriptures tell us, anyone who trusts in him will never be disgraced. So if you've never done that, if you've never put your trust in Jesus Christ, if you've never confessed with your mouth that he is Lord over you, over everything, over your life, today is the day of salvation. It's not tomorrow. It's not when I'm out of college and I've had all my fun now and now I can like get really conservative and be a Christian and take my kids to church. No, today is the day of salvation. Because we don't know how long we have. And you want those promises, right? All those promises that I listed off, how many people here like don't want any of those? Exactly. Because they're good. And you can have them. They're free. Believe in your heart that Jesus Christ is Lord and confess with your mouth. You know, I'm not going to do like an altar call and have everybody come up and or do one of those like, everybody close your eyes, raise your hand if you want to be saved. And then I start lying and be like, I see your hand and everybody's hand is up. So nobody thinks I like messed up. I didn't do it right. I don't know. I've never peeped and and seen if that's what pastors do, because I'm a good Christian, I don't teach. But what I do want to say is that verse tells you everything you need to know about how you get saved. That's how you now have right standing with the Lord. If you want to be walked through that, there are leaders here. You can talk to me, you can talk to Dan, you can talk to Lexi, Tessa. I'm not going to name through everybody, but there's a lot of people in here that you can talk to about that. Because today is the day of salvation. You want these promises. You want the mercy of God. You want the grace of God. I don't know how long I was going. I don't know how long I'm really supposed to go. But that's what I have, because the gospel, as complex as the promises of God are, at the same time, God knows we're simple, so he made the gospel simple. It's believe this and confess this and you're saved, and now these promises are yours. So live in the gospel. For those of us that are Christians right now, daily, pick up your cross and carry it, and allow the cross to carry you through. Go back to those promises. Go back to this word, this life-giving word, this awesome word of God. Go back to it daily, because you need it. You'll fail without it. That's honestly all I have. I don't know. But if we could all just bow our heads and pray real quick and just take a moment. Lord, you are awesome, God. You've promised us so much life. Jesus says, I've come to give life abundantly. You've given that to us freely. Nothing we could do could make us deserve that, God. It's only by your love, by your grace, by your mercy. Lord, we thank you for sending Jesus Christ to die on the cross for us and be raised to life so we can experience that, God. Lord, I pray for everybody here. If there's anyone here that does not know you, God, soften their heart right now. Draw them to you. We plead with them. We plead with them, Lord. Thank you for those of us that are saved. Your word says we become your beloved, God. We are beloved. You cherish us. Help us live in that every single day, Lord. Help us return to our first love. Return to where we built that first altar, God, with you. Let us never forget how awesome the gospel is. How awesome the gospel is that it compels us to worship. And we worship you best by obeying you, by telling others about you, by loving you, God. So Lord, I pray that the gospel would never leave our hearts and never leave our minds and never, ever leave our lips, Lord, that it would always be spoken by us. Lord, I just thank you for every heart here. I thank you for their willingness to listen right now, God. And Lord, we pray over those of us that are leaving MCC, that your hand of protection would be on them, that your favor would be with them, Lord. And we thank you for this word, God. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Mm-hmm.